Today we're going to look at hypergraph isomorphism in three parts. Hypergraphs without repeated edges, hypergraphs with repeated edges, and the incidence graph perspective. So, how can we tell whether two hypergraphs without repeated edges have the same structure? Since our hypergraphs have no repeated edges, we can identify each edge in a hypergraph with the collection of vertices it contains, allowing us to define the collection of edges as a set of sets. Let G and H be hypergraphs. We say that G is isomorphic to H if there's a bijection F from the set of vertices of G to the set of vertices of H, such that the image under F of any set S of vertices in G is an edge in H if and only if S is an edge in G. This means that F is a mapping of vertices that preserves edges both ways. Any bijection that satisfies this condition is referred to as a hypergraph isomorphism between G and H. I encourage you to verify that when restricted to graphs or two uniform hypergraphs, our definition of hypergraph isomorphism agrees with that for graph isomorphism. Next, let's work through an example. Let's show, using our definition of isomorphism, that these hypergraphs are isomorphic. To do this, we need to find a mapping between the vertices of G and the vertices of H that preserves edges in both directions. Let's try the function f, which maps 1 to b, 2 to c, 3 to d, and 4 to a. This is a bijective function, so all that's left to verify is that it preserves edges in both directions. Starting with edge e sub 1, the image of e sub 1, which is just the set containing 1 in G, is the set containing B in H, which is an edge in H. Next, the image of E sub 2 is the set containing A, C, and D in H, which is an edge. Finally, the image of E sub 3 is the set containing A, B, and D in H, which is again an edge. In the other direction, the inverse image of X sub 1 is the set containing 1. The inverse image of X sub 2 is the set containing 1, 3, and 4. And the inverse image of X sub 3 is the set containing 2, 3, and 4. All of these sets are edges in G, so we can say that the function f preserves edges both ways, so it's an isomorphism, and G and H are isomorphic. Moving on, let's examine the case of hypergraphs where we allow for repeated edges. In a hypergraph with repeated edges, we can no longer identify edges solely from the set of vertices they contain. There are a few ways we could proceed to define the collection of edges, but for now, we can continue to define the collection of edges as a set of objects together with an incidence function, alpha sub g, that maps an edge e to the set of vertices we want it to contain. The first thing we should ask ourselves is, when we allow for repeated edges, can we keep the same definition as before for isomorphic hypergraphs and still satisfy our intuitive sense for what isomorphic hypergraphs should be? Well, consider the two hypergraphs shown here. Intuitively, they shouldn't be isomorphic because one has more than one edge containing the same three vertices, and the other has just one edge containing the same three vertices. However, if we adapt our current definition of isomorphism to mean that there's a vertex mapping F that preserves sets of vertices that form an edge both ways, whereby forms an edge, we mean that the set is the image under an incidence function of some edge object, then these hypergraphs are isomorphic with the following isomorphism F. I encourage you to verify that under F, a set of vertices in G is mapped to a set of vertices that form an edge in H, if and only if that set forms an edge in G. This example shows us that the problem with our original definition of isomorphism, when applied to the case of hypergraphs with repeated edges, is that it's not able to tell whether hypergraphs have different numbers of edges that are incident to a given set of vertices. To correct this problem, let's redefine isomorphic hypergraphs as follows, assuming that our hypergraphs do not have empty edges. G is isomorphic to H if we can construct a bijection F between the vertex set of G and the vertex set of H, and a bijection gamma between the edge set of G and the edge set of H, such that for any edge E in G, the image under F of the set of vertices incident to E equals the set of vertices incident to gamma of E in hypergraph H. To demonstrate how this new definition takes repeated edges into consideration, let's look at our previous example. The hypergraphs in this example don't even have the same number of edges, so there's no way we could construct a bijection between their edge sets. So under our updated definition, we can say they're not isomorphic. Let's look at another example. To show these hypergraphs are isomorphic, we need to construct a bijection F between vertices and a bijection gamma between edges in these hypergraphs, such that gamma satisfies the criteria in our definition of isomorphism. In this case, the following mapping F should work. It takes vertex 1 to B, 2 to A, 3 to C, and 4 to D. Next, there are 6 ways we could define a bijection between the edge sets, but only 2 of them satisfy the criteria in our definition of isomorphism. To demonstrate, while the choice of gamma, highlighted in green, that takes E sub 1 to X sub 1 is a bijection, F of alpha sub G of E sub 1 is the set containing BC, which is not the same as alpha sub H of gamma of E sub 1, which is the set containing A, C, and D. On the other hand, if we choose one of the mappings highlighted in yellow, our function does satisfy the property in our definition of isomorphism. Since we were able to construct the mappings gamma and F that meet the criteria in our definition for isomorphism, we can say these hypergraphs are isomorphic. Before we cover the last concept of the video, I encourage you to verify that our new definition of hypergraph isomorphism, when restricted to the case of hypergraphs without repeated edges, agrees with our first definition of hypergraph isomorphism. To finish the video, I'd like to show you something really interesting about our new definition. If you recall from hypergraph episode 2, the incidence graph of a hypergraph H, which we'll denote by I of H for now, is an ordinary graph in which there's a vertex for each edge and for each vertex in H, and in which two vertices are adjacent if one corresponds to an edge in H, the other corresponds to a vertex in H, and that edge and vertex are incident in H. The incidence graph of a hypergraph is always bipartite, as in a hypergraph, vertices are never incident to vertices and edges are never incident to edges. This means that the set of vertices in the incidence graph corresponding to the hypergraph's edges forms an independent set, as does the set of vertices corresponding to vertices in the hypergraph. If you look closely at our new definition of hypergraph isomorphism, you'll see that it's equivalent to saying that the incidence graphs of G and H are isomorphic, where the isomorphism preserves respective bipartition. This means it maps edge vertices in I of G to edge vertices in I of H, and vertex vertices in I of G to vertex vertices in I of H. To demonstrate, let's look back to our previous example and take the incidence graphs of these hypergraphs. Notice that they're isomorphic, and our chosen isomorphism preserves vertex and edge parts. Also, if we look all the way back to our example of non-isomorphic hypergraphs, notice how the incidence graphs are not isomorphic. Finally, here's an example of non-isomorphic hypergraphs whose incidence graphs are isomorphic, but where there's no isomorphism that preserves bipartition. This can only occur when the hypergraphs are duals of each other. That's it for this video. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe and click the like button. Have a great day.